It is September the 9th, 2021, and you're watching Curiously Polar. I keep saying you're watching, but I think most people are actually listening to this. So welcome to the listeners and to the watchers. I'm Chris, and there's Henry and Mario. Hello.
Mario,
yes, how are you?
I'm doing fine up here in Tromsø with a nice drizzly 9th of September
thing. We just realized that, okay, here in northern Germany, we are going to have like 26, 27, 28 degrees today. It's the 9th of September. Henry, you're not doing much different where you are?
No, pretty much the same temperatures.
And what's the temperature up in the Arctic?
Well, right now in Tromsø is 7 degrees.
Yay.
And it's in between rain showers. It's been like this since last year. I don't know, since I remember.
Well, anyway, so coming to you from at least two different climate zones, and that is as it should be. So let us kick off. Wait, actually, we have a question. We have a question from a listener who listened to the last episode where we talked about underwater drones and things, and he asks if anyone has ever done searches on the seafloor for 18th and 19th century whaling ships around Spitsbergen, ships that were there because his ancestors used to be fishing up there, and some didn't return. So do we know if there is any information on those? Is it even feasible that something is still up there?
Oh, certainly.
Certainly. I mean, if you look at Sweden, the Vasa is a good example for a wooden ship that has stayed underwater for quite a while and then been brought up again. How about Spitsbergen?
Well, the conditions for preservation of wood underwater are quite good because of the low temperatures. There is a problem, of course, of the ice breaking everything in its wake with the ice foot, like the bottom of the sea ice moving mm-hmm. about and crunching everything down to maybe, I don't know, 5-10 meters depth. So shallow wrecks are probably destroyed, but there is a wealth of wrecks probably up, especially in the northwest of Svalbard, and I think that I do not know directly of any wrecks, because these are usually kept quite secret by the only if you are a marine archaeologist you get to know where they are and if they have not been taken up. But I think that I remember at the museum in Barentsburg they have a few pomor remainders, like things like porcelain pipes and other things that were from wrecks of pomor origin. So the Russian hunters, they were predating the, let's say, the more Western European hunters there. And I think that the Susan Barr, the state antiquary of Norway, has published a book about something like that for Svalbard. But we don't have it in the... But we'll check. We'll check for
okay, but there's not to your knowledge some sort of public catalog or something about those.
To my knowledge, there is no public catalog, yeah. And it would be quite difficult. Just as an example, the first steam whaler by Sven Foyn, the whaling ship that has started it all for the industrial whaling, called the Spessenfide. It was spes et fide in Latin, like hope and faith. Mm-hmm. It was the first ship that was equipped with the steam turbines and that had a exploding grenade harpoon gun on the front.
Okay.
Like, this is the first modern whaling ship. It's just out here of Tromsø. It's in a very very secret position, but it's just a few hundred meters on the southwest of the island.
secret to avoid treasure hunters.
Pillage.
To go out
yeah,
there.
Treasure hunters. Yeah.
Yes, okay.
Exactly.
I understand. That's the kind of tourism that you don't really need.
No, but there are more and more underwater drones. Now we talked about this penguin-like drone that is autonomous. A lot is used in one of the projects that we mentioned last week about the plankton or the ice algae. They are using also for sampling a tether drone made by Blue Eye Technology up here in Norway. And a lot of the new expedition ships or old expedition ships are being equipped with these tethered drones that are more affordable. I mean, still, we're talking about the cost of a small car, at least in Germany, not in Norway. yes. Oh, we're talking about equipment that might cost around 7,000-8,000 euros. So yeah. it's not really something that is available to just about anybody. But
right.
But they are the technology is becoming more and more available.
And the good thing with that technology to add on that, because we actually have that on board in Antarctica as well, particularly from that manufacturer, is really. It serves more than just one purpose, right? You get a nice footage for marketing purposes. You grant the guests a view, which very, very few people actually.
Oh, and there he froze. Oh,
he froze. Yeah.
Oh, yes. I froze.
Oh, yeah, now you're back. Now you're back. Okay.
Yeah. I just got the information network connection lost.
Let's keep trying anyway.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah.
So
good.
On today's episode, we want to talk about books, our favorite books about the Arctic and the Antarctic. And we figured out, maybe Henry, could you hold up, or both of you, could you hold up your stack of books that you have put next to the camera?
Wait a second.
Just a show for all the listeners out there, the viewers out there. So Henry, this is the biggest stack of books.
I can't lift all of them because they are on the sides, on both sides, and
so dear listeners, don't worry. We have I've made an executive decision that we have three books each for this episode. So both Henry and Mario will show their favorite books, three of them. But because that is definitely not enough, we are going to make this at least a two-part episode. So there will be another follow-up, and maybe you can share.
I think it's going to become a recurring theme
probably
for the next years.
Probably. So if any of you listening have your favorite books about the Arctic, the Antarctic, let us know. YouTube comments is a good place to put that. But before we dig into the books, let's look at the Arctic newsreel. We still don't have a jingle for it, but
polar. We really have to work on
polar. Polar newsreel. Yeah. Polar newsreel.
Not just Arctic.
That's true. Let us talk about polar bears, rockets, expeditions, penguins, krill, and the Russians. Mario.
The Russians.
Take it away.
Oh my gosh.
Take it away.
Yes, the first thing that came up is a new article that has appeared in the journal called Arctic. It's open source, and you'll have the link. And it's about the use of tools by polar bears for procuring food. Now, the authors here are Ian Sterling, and he is the most well-known polar bear scientist. But then you have two other, at least for me, colleagues. Christine Lader, who is working from the US, from the Seattle. And Eric Bourne, who was my PhD supervisor, is now retired, but he's still associated with the Greenland Institute of Natural Resources. And they are all of them very serious scientists. Now, the background is that there are stories of polar bears hurling rocks down at walruses and other species that they might be hunting, like seals or something. So what, and these three colleagues, they have been looking at the anecdotal information about these stories, and they have been actually trying to compile this, and they found out that it might actually have happened for real. It's not just something that the Inuit guides have told their the explorers just to have a laugh behind their back. It is possible. And of course, the conformation of the coast must be important. I mean, polar bears do not just take rocks up and lift them and crack the head of a seal. But if they come in situations like in some places where you have a cliff and there are walruses down at the beach and the polar bear comes up from the top, they might be able to roll down boulders and pieces of ice and something. And
just have this picture in my mind of a polar bear bowling, like with a bowling alley with walrus.
Exactly.
And I think that was the problem why it initially wasn't taken seriously, because the accounts have been made already 1800 by Inuit, by local Inuit living in the area.
Right.
And it is one of many examples that Inuit accounts have not been taken seriously in scientific research or historic accounts, right?
That is interesting, because the Inuit are very close to this, so you should take them even more seriously.
Yeah, but just remember the Franklin expedition. There have been Inuit accounts long, long time back, actually very few years after the disappearance of Franklin, where there were very clear Inuit accounts where the ship has sunk, and they have been largely ignored, and eventually they found the ship exactly at that
exactly
position.
Exactly there. Yes, exactly. And you have to understand also that polar bears, especially for walruses, I mean, it's well known, and maybe some of the listeners and you have certainly have seen the footage of the polar bear scaring away the walrus herd. That is including also calves, so young walruses, and the stampeding walrus group that is going to the water because they are being scared by the polar bear is actually trampling down the young that are in the herd, in the middle of the herd. And so the polar bears can pluck them out more easily, either because they are stunned or they are left alone or they are dead.
And tool use in the animal kingdom is not unusual. We have plenty of occurrences. Crows, for example, and other animals do that.
Yeah.
But I think it's more limited in an area like the Arctic, particularly the polar bear, which is largely connected to the sea ice, to get tools there. It's very hard to imagine having some tools there. And what scientists figured out now in that research is that they not only use rocks on the coastline, but also ice chunks to use tools to either roll or throw it at walruses. And the problem with human imagination is we always try to connect it to human behavior, right? Picking it up and throwing feels like gripping it with a hand and just throw it and target it to something. If we describe it like that, it might look different with a bear, but it nonetheless means that the bear picked up the chunk of ice to use it as a tool to crack a skull.
All right, let's move on to space. How about that?
Yeah, and this is about this is from the Barents Observer. They were actually reporting of a notice by the Russian authorities that there might be pieces of the cowling of a Soyuz rocket that are going to be falling tonight right in the area that's between the south of Spitsbergen, Bear Island, and Hopen. I'm particularly attentive to this because Best Explorer is actually a few miles northwest of Bjørnøya or
that's
Bear Island.
That's the
right
ship
now.
Of your dad.
Yes, my father is up there. So I was came up on this, and it's actually quite interesting because it's an area, as you see in the picture now on the screen, that is full of fishing. Now, if you take Spitsbergen and the triangle on the top, on the center of the picture, and then Bear Island is exactly in the middle, And then Hopen is up on the right, a little bit on the right. So it's a place where there is a large number of ships at the moment.
Yeah. It's a very productive marine area there.
Yeah, yeah, it's a fishing area, and so mostly they are.
It is still quite unlikely that a ship gets hit, but just imagine what a glorious way to go this would be. I mean, just yes. What a story!
It's about to be really unlucky.
Piece of a rocket. I'm not sure if that's so glorious.
Exactly.
But it raises again the question how we organize our space encounters. Are so many leftovers just dumped in the ocean, right?
Yeah. Yeah, and not only not everything actually burns on the re-entry. Yeah. So it is interesting that there are quite a lot of wrecks there, probably also the wreck of the Latham aircraft that where Amundsen disappeared. But there are also lots of different wrecks. It's quite a populated area.
which takes us nicely into the next newsreel topic. What a segue. We stay with the Barents Observer. Apparently, exactly. There is stuff underwater that has been found, and it's not so nice.
Yeah. And this is a report from a cruise, and actually I've heard this also from a colleague the other day in work-related thing, is that this cruise actually was looking for different things, but among others, radioactive waste. Because in the early days of the Cold War, there had been an accident, and there have been several accidents, but this one here is one of the most famous with a submarine, and the reactors have been put in a container and then dumped in the southwest of the Novaya Zemlya island, and they have been kind of forgotten. And this cruise now has located the container with the broken reactors, nuclear reactors, and they are thinking about ways of taking up this container and disposing of it in a more, let's say, environmentally friendly way, if we can say that about nuclear waste.
Wow.
And that's also something that has been neglected a lot in the past, because obviously, during the Cold War times, was big secrecy between the blocks to hide certain accidents. But this one was one of those which couldn't really be hidden. However, that because there was no big intention to actually do something about that, that just went really dormant as a topic. Now, leading into a fact, and you have it just on the screen right now, that at the moment, there is thought to be 17,000 radioactive objects in the oceans. And most of them are actually really aggregating in the Kara Sea, where a lot of the nuclear fleet left the leftovers. Like, for example, as the article also stated, the old reactors of the icebreaker Lenin, which was a very famous icebreaker as well. So it's quite a topic.
It's quite a topic, and I find that it's reassuring, or it's refreshing to hear that the Russian authorities are actually taking this very seriously, and I think, you know, cleaning up of all of these sites, or at least part of these sites. It's a good development, and I really commend the Russian authorities for this, and the Russian scientists for coming up with these proposals for these cruises. So you have cruises that are doing other oceanographic surveys, but they also take up these signals, and they publishing.
Russia having the chair of the Arctic Council at the moment is quite supportive in that regard.
Exactly,
so.
Exactly, and it's quite nice. Yeah.
All right. From nuclear waste, let's talk about penguins that have defects. I think that's probably the right term.
It's maybe exaggerating saying defects, but they are kind of different penguins.
Well, okay, so this is titled as Penguin Misfits. What are those?
Yes, exactly. And this is because penguins, like all animals, have a difference of coloration. But when you see a group of penguins, you see them all in their tuxedo uniform, and they are kind of very much alike. You wouldn't be able to tell the one from the other. But they can have genetically some differences, and And then, I mean, they do have genetical differences, and some of them have different colorations. So as you see here, you have a few examples of what they call them misfits in this article.
I love the nicknames they gave them.
Yes, exactly.
That's okay. let me read them. There's Batman, there's like Creme Fresh, there's Ninja, there's Crop Top, there's Platinum, and there's the White Russian that we are again yes. with the Russians.
The Russians there. And here, I think that we're only looking at the Adélie penguins. But, I mean, I've seen king penguins, melanistic yes. king penguins, and they are... I mean, genetically, they are different. They can be different gradations of black or white or beige or something, leucistic if they are whitish, melanistic if they are blackish. And the main idea here is that the penguins that are different, the idea, the preconceived idea or like the theory is that they would have lower reproductive success. And the interesting part about this article is that actually it doesn't look like they can detect the differences in reproductive success for these penguins. So being different doesn't mean that you are going to be keeping your genes for yourself. So aka not reproducing. In this case, they can reproduce, and they did reproduce like almost any other penguin.
I would expect them to be more popular because they are special, you know, because they look different.
Well, one thing,
want to be special.
One thing, yeah, exactly. One thing is being special because a potential mate might see you and prefer you rather than your friend on the side there. But the other thing is being visible to predators or being like more visible to, yeah.
You stick out from the crowd.
Or to prey.
And, yeah.
Yeah, there's a reason for the color patterns that evolve with penguins. And you find that pattern with almost all marine mammals in the sea.
And fish.
Yeah, and fish as well.
Black on like dark on the side, on the back, and clear on the belly.
Right. Yeah.
But the other thing that could be interesting to think about is that actually, if you have a different coloration that is a kind of disadvantageous because the prey probably sees you or the predator can see you, you might actually, if you survive and you get to reproductive age, you might actually be much stronger and much more fit than the other because you have to fight worse odds. So that is also one way of looking at it. But
all right.
Good, and I'm happy for the different penguins.
Good. Very good.
Me too.
Okay. I can't find a good segue. Let's talk about krill fishing. And for this, you've given us an article from The Guardian.
Yeah, the segue here is that, of course, penguins, like many of the animals down in the Antarctic, they feed on krill. And krill is an extremely important resource. It's the key player in the ecosystem down there, from birds to mammals to fish, and everybody eats krill or some derivative of the krill. And krill has been used, there have been fishing for krill for producing animal feed, mainly for fish farms. Krill is not particularly palatable if taken from down there, especially because of the fluoride in the shells or in the exoskeleton that is kind of poisonous for us. And penguins have a way of dealing with it by regurgitating the stomach lining when it gets too saturated with fluoride. So there are ways of dealing with this. Whales have a special system in their kidneys to get rid of all this excess fluoride. And but the main attention now is for health products like omega-3 products.
Fish oil capsules,
exactly. And of course, if you can say this is omega-3 oils that is coming from the pure waters of the Antarctic, then you have already a marketing advantage. Or you can say that the CAMELAR, the organization that is dealing with the regulation of fishing and the marine resources in the around the Antarctica, if they say it's okay to fish krill, then you have also a blue stamp on your applications for doing this. Mm-hmm. And it looks like there is the more and more interest, and there are more and more ships going down there. And I am not really sure that this is a good idea. Now, the article from The Guardian here is written by an organization that is openly opposed to creel fishing, so we have to take it as a with a grain of salt. But it is something that you're saying, like, hey, now maybe, just maybe, do we really need to go down there and take also the krill and do a lot of krill fishing? Yeah, is it really going to be sustainable or not?
How dangerous is that for the environment? Because you said krill is the basis for everything down there, and that means, yeah, by taking it out of the water, that means you're not leaving, potentially not leaving enough for the other life there.
Well, there is a lot of krill. And now I don't have the numbers from Kamler, but there is a lot of krill, and the fishing fleet for krill is minute compared to the influence of krill fishing is like this. Right. But, you know, it's also difficult to imagine how this will develop. And we have been able to take down the populations of a lot of fish species and shrimps and crustaceans. So we have the potential of also being very detrimental to krill if we are not careful. And it would be really good to be careful also in this case here. We are on a good way. We are having a good control over the activities around Antarctica. We're having an increase, a very nice increase in the population of whales. The penguins are also doing quite okay. Most of the population of penguins are doing quite okay. So we are on the right track. But this is due to the reduced extraction of resources from the ecosystem. Right. So it would be good to keep on like that. And it also would be good if Henry came back.
Henry has we have lost Henry's camera, but I think he's scrambling to get another battery in the camera. If that doesn't work, just use the laptop camera.
It's not only the camera, it's also, for some reason, the connection.
Yeah, you updated your computer earlier today. That's a problem.
Not voluntarily. It just happened overnight and surprised me this morning.
My theory is that he wanted to let me know that I should stop talking about krill.
No, actually, I wanted to participate in that because it's really an important topic. Yeah. And it is the source of the abundance of marine wildlife in Antarctica. So for us, for people going down there to showcase the place, that's a really essential part for the ecosystem down in Antarctica. It's a very essential part. And if the krill fishery just goes up as it does right now by 15 to 20% each year, then at some point the krill stock will just plummet into regions where it can't support the amount of wildlife down there anymore.
Cascade effect,
and that will have a big impact on the global ocean behavior, on the global ocean patterns. Because what we try to, or what we tend to forget, is the bigger impacts. It's not that we just put one piece out of the puzzle and the rest of the puzzle stays the same. There have been many studies of what kind of impact penguins have to the marine wildlife, what kind of impact whales have on marine wildlife, how much the oceans actually changed after the height of whaling in the Southern Ocean. So there's a big impact on that. So it's not just the tiny little krill that disappears because it doesn't really affect us. It's fish oil, and we can just take another source, right? It's a bigger picture.
And it's also the that we do the removals in a totally different way than whales and penguins and albatrosses and petrels and all this. We are taking the resource and we are moving it away to another part of the planet. While a whale, a penguin, a petrel would eat the krill and then naturally more or less in situ remineralize give back to the environment the mineral salts, the ions and everything that's in the feces, and that is actually promoting a fertilization of the environment.
Exactly.
While we are just moving it away. Plus that there is a risk of accidents, risk of mishaps. And you know, like an oil spill is from a wreck is it's not a nice thing to do. Certainly. And the krill is actually cooked on board in order to preserve it, or like part of the product is treated on board. So there is actually just a little more of an activity and a little more complex activity than just taking it out from the ocean.
So
the problem with conservation bodies is that saving the whale was kind of a cute thing because whales are looking very nice and they're behaving very nice. But saving krill is a much more difficult topic because it doesn't
a hard
have
sell,
such
yes.
a nice icon as a picture, right?
Yeah, and saving the whales also came at a moment in time of the economy where whale oil was actually coming out of the picture anyways. So it didn't disturb too much the global industry because there were other products that could be taken over. Like here, we are actually opening a new market. We are opening new things, and there is no real alternative. So there is no natural economical.
Exactly the same like the whalers and sealers did just 100 years ago.
It's not much different, yeah. Staying with the Russian theme, we had rocket parts hitting the Barents Sea. We had nuclear waste in the Barents Sea. There's apparently a bit of a freak accident that happened. What is that all about?
Yeah, that was a very interesting news report.
And that's
a very sad one. It includes actually the Minister for Russian Emergency Situations, Yevgeny Zinichev. And he participated on a drill in the Arctic, including 6,000 people who've been involved there. And apparently he died during those drills by the attempt to rescue a very famous award-winning director who was researching for an upcoming documentary together with him. And Alexander Melnik, the director, just fell into the water and without really thinking, Zinichev just jumped in and tried to rescue him and died there together with Melnik. So actually both people died in that incident.
It was a rock, like he was hitting a rock, wasn't he?
Yes.
Like as he dove in the water. That's really, oh my gosh, yes.
So that seems a real accident, no foul play or anything.
No, that's actually a real accident. I think the reason why it took such a high wave and media coverage is really it's a minister. It's a very high official. And he was very close to Vladimir Putin. They have been working together very long. Zinichev used to be a bodyguard of Putin. And that, triggered Putin to actually release a personal press release on this incident.
Yeah.
All right.
Sad story. So accidents happen. Yeah.
Indeed.
With that, let us get on to the main topic. This is already going on for ever, but the main topic, the books. See why I limited this to three books each? There we go.
I can see that.
and it's the two of you bringing three books each, because I only bring one book each, and it's not even necessarily that Arctic.
Okay, you start then.
I start with, because I do not have a big collection about Arctic, Antarctic books. All I know about it, I learned from online and from YouTube. So this is my classroom here, so to speak. But I remember from my childhood, I remember a book that had some of the themes in it, and that might have actually planted a bit of a seed in me when it comes to the cold climates. And it's a story by Raymond Briggs. It's a children's book called The Snowman, and it's well known to all the listeners from the UK. It was in the 80s made into an animated film. It's like 27 minutes long. You can watch it on YouTube. It has all the themes in it that are there. There's polar bears, there's Norway, there's snow, there's ice, there's icebergs, there's polar lights, lots of them, very colorful, like blue, red, green, orange, everything. And there's even Santa Claus, and penguins, which kind of don't work with the North Pole, but that's artistic license.
It's a traveling snowman.
It's a license.
It's artistic license, but it is really. I only realized that later on that this is part of what formed my interest in the cold. So there we go, the snowman.
You wanted to figure out how the snowman is able to fly.
This was back then. The sequence with the flying snowman and the boy was a pretty groundbreaking when it comes to animation, like full animation, 3D type of stuff and so on. Yeah. So.
And then you realize that there are winds that are very strong. Like now, for example, out of Newfoundland, there is a storm. There are 62, 65 knots out there. So, and the snowman actually can fly there.
So it ticked all my boxes. And if you want to watch it, then again, it's 27 minutes long. It's on YouTube. We'll put a link in the show notes. But now let's go to the serious kind of books.
But before we do, I would really love to give a little shout out to one of our listeners, Robert Spaglieri, who actually triggered that episode, because he wrote an email months ago. And we've been in contact on that, where he just said he would love to hear or get some recommendations on polar books, and if we couldn't make an episode on that. And he recommended a book to me, which I actually read at this very moment, unfortunately not in a physical way, because shipping them here costs a fortune, so I try to buy them when I'm traveling. But on an ebook reader, that's also very nice. And the book is called Floating Coast. And it's a book about the environmental history of the Bering Strait. And having traveled in the area, it's a very interesting area. And this book is, as he said, one of the reasons why he turns more and more into an environmentalist and really being interested in environmental topics. The perspective is a foreigner's perspective into the native communities that actually form the Bering Strait, overarching from the Alaskan side and the Russian side, and all the three different native nations of Chukchi, of Yupik, and Inupiat. And it's a very interesting, very nice book. I just started reading it, but that for me was really like the reason why I wanted to push the topic. And I actually also want to start to actually build the bridge to Chris's book. I browsed a bookstore in Bucharest in Romania. It's the capital of Romania, which doesn't look very nice to me. It's a lot of concrete. But I had a very nice and well-organized bookstore, and I couldn't go past the naughty penguin.
The naughty
fantastic.
Penguin.
It's really amazing. It's three little penguins. It's actually just 6 pages or 8 pages or something like that. And those naughty little penguins, three of them, they just waddle around and trick pretty much every little animal they find around, a leopard seal, an orca. It's really amazing, an albatross. And eventually, the lesson learned is you should treat everyone nice, because at one point you will rely on them. So or be eaten. So
all
I
right.
thought for future children, that's like a book I want to have.
Perfect. So as we are about to go through 6 books, and in the interest of using everyone's time wisely, I'm going to give each of you 3 minutes per book.
Holy crap.
Tell us what it's the title, what it's about, and why you recommend people read it. Mario, how about you go first?
Okay. I'm going to be very naughty, because I am giving you 2 books by
you smuggled
Tillman.
One in. You smuggled one
I
in.
Smuggled one in. Now, Tillman is was a fantastic person. I mean, he was a military person. He was originally. He bicycled through Africa on a diet mainly of bananas, in a time where probably wasn't very wise to travel that much. But in the 70s, he had a ship called Mischief, a sailing boat, a Bristol cutter. You can see it maybe here in the picture here. And he was an alpinist, and it was a precursor of going for expeditions, and he organized the first ascents of a lot of mountains in the North Atlantic, mainly in Greenland and Spitsbergen. So these books are, one is called Ice with Everything, and it's a fantastic story of an expedition to Greenland. And Triumph and Tribulation is another one. They are not very thick, but they are you read them in one go. And it's for expeditions in 74, 75, and 76 to Svalbard, East Greenland, and West Greenland. If you're interested about sailing on an old ship, going mountaineering with the equipment that one had in the 70s, these are just amazing.
Wonderful. Links are going to be in the show notes. Henry, your first book, please.
My first book, I just finished 2 weeks back, I think. It's John Gertner's The Ice at the End of the World, which is a pretty amazing book for a number of reasons. But let me talk about John Gertner first. He is a contributing author or writer for the New York Times magazine, and he went on a trip for a feature article to Greenland, and was just part of a program called Airbridge or Icebridge. And Icebridge was a very, very important NASA project, which actually created an elevation model for the Arctic, for not only for the Arctic, also then later for Antarctica. And John Gertner was so fascinated by that he actually used that as a start to research 150 years of exploration history in Greenland. And he starts really from the scratch, from the whalers going there. He's covering all the big and the non-so-big expeditions and explorers, and eventually ends up at the ice core drillings, starting with the expedition of... now I'm missing... Alfred Wegener, exactly. Alfred Wegener in Eismitte. And when we talked about the summit station and the rain summit station last episode, that's exactly the place where nowadays still the ice core drilling is continued. And all of that is in here. It's written in a very, very nice way. It's a very entertaining way. He has a very amazing style to write. So for me, it was very difficult to put that book aside. John Gertner, The Ice at the End of the World, An Epic Journey into Greenland's Buried Past and Our Perilous Future. Really a recommendation.
All right. So that's the all-encompassing history.
It is. It's almost an encyclopedia. It's really, really awesome.
Awesome. Yeah. Okay. Fantastic. Mario, you're next.
Yeah, and I go back to books that might be difficult to find, because these Tillman books, I wonder if they are still available, but you find them on antiquaries and eBay and things. But another book that has been fantastic for me, because I worked in Northeast Greenland, is by David Howarth, and it's called The Sledge Patrol.
This looks well read. This copy looks well read.
Yeah. This copy was given to me by a researcher, Mike Lee, that was at the University College in London. And he was doing some recordings, so sound recordings on narwhals in the 1999 and 2000 with his wife Kate, just the two of them on two Metzler zodiacs out there. And we shared a few meals together. And he gave it to me. It's a book that is published in 57. So it's 1957. But it's a story of the wartime in East Greenland, the establishment of the Sirius patrol, Sirius like the star, that is patrolling nowadays, the sledge patrol out in northeast Greenland. And it is all the stories during the war of the German weather station being positioned there, and the local hunters, both Norwegian and Danish, actually trying to combat this, and what's happened to these men. And it's the subtitle is A True Story of the Strangest Battlefront of All, because it was a very interesting episode in World War II. By the way, David Howarth is also the author of We Die Alone. And it's also a film nice now, title. And it's about an episode here just north of Tromsø during the war of survival, during the war of a Norwegian military person that was shot by the German invaders here and managed to escape in a fantastic way. But The Sledge Patrol, David Howarth.
Perfect. Henry.
I am heading down to the south, and I would like to recommend Nick Bertozzi's graphic novel Shackleton at Arctic Odyssey. The story of Shackleton is very famous, is very popular. It's probably one of the most documented stories, simply because it was a very positive outcome. He was really the boss. And Nick Bertozzi chose a different approach, a different way, and just created a graphic novel to reach a different audience, to reach people who not so much would read biographies or factual books, but would more or less dig into comics, graphic novels. And I stumbled across that book in Ljubljana, in Slovenia, not long ago, and I couldn't resist to buy it, simply because of the connection to an Arctic history. And I really enjoyed the way it's black and white, but that doesn't take a lot of it. It really focuses more on the story, and I really, really enjoy that, admire it. It's a very nice way to retell the story of Sir Ernest Shackleton, Nick Bertozzi, Shackleton, Antarctic Odyssey. Really amazing.
That looks like a cool format.
It is,
yeah,
and it will certainly
Will certainly
reach audiences that wouldn't read a big fat book. Yeah,
It's really nice. It has beautiful maps in there as well, explaining where Antarctica is. And can you see that? There you go. So there is really quite some add on to it. It's not just another comic book. It really, A, it's a true story, and B, it adds quite some educational elements into that without being the teacher, right? Also, cool. Like a map of Elephant Island, where they actually landed. Awesome.
Cool. Wow. Okay. Last book, third one is The Charm, Mario.
Yes, and this time it's only one book. It's I'm going in a totally different way than Henry, so it's really good because I'm going west, and I'm going west. We started Svalbard, Greenland, and now we have, for one last time, I will go the Northwest Passage.
Awesome, yeah.
Pierre Berton, the Arctic Grail.
Ooh.
Now you can find this. This I found also on eBay. It's the most complete and thorough book about the Northwest Passage up to, here it says 1909. So we are talking about the first expeditions, both the, it's a quest for the Northwest Passage. There's also the land expeditions by Franklin and the, like all of the exploration on the area. So it doesn't include the latest development of finding the Erebus and the Terror, of course. This is an old book, but if you're passionate about the Northwest Passage, this is the one book that will tell you about all the different rescue attempts, especially to find the Northwest Passage, but also the expeditions, the Kane expedition up in Northwest Greenland, and the, like, everything that is to do with going west,
and it's also closely related. I mean, it's really the Davis Strait, the Baffin Bay, the Baffin Island, all the explorations that included not only the official expeditions but a lot of whaler history. Really, really amazing. It's a great book.
So do me a favor and show this from the side just to get an idea how heavy. Oh yeah, this is a book. This is a proper,
I mean, this
book.
This is a book that you,
not a book with
as my grandmother would say. I mean, if you have a hardcover that is almost 700 pages, you don't want to read it in bed because it falls down on your nose.
Perfect. Okay, and last but not least, Henry, take us out of here with your third suggestion.
And we stay in the Arctic, which is actually not really true, but it's the home of my next choice, which is one of my most favorite authors of all time, Andri Snøhre Magnusson. I had the luck to sit down with Andri two times to interview him on different topics, but he wrote an amazing book about Iceland and why Iceland has lost a little bit their connection to nature. And he just wrote so many different things. He started as a poet, writing poetry that was sold in Bonos, which is like the cheapest supermarket chain in Iceland. Bonos poetry was it called. He later on wrote children's books. He wrote novels, and he came back last year with a book, Oktima and Vatnith, on time and water, which is really a beautiful book, not only from the cover, but he tackles the topic of climate change in a way that I find very, very amazing and astonishing, because he takes it on a personal voyage. He paints the picture of his grandma and his daughter, and just builds the arc of his grandma, which is the great grandma of his daughter, and her his daughter, and just shows how many years those lifespans actually entail. And when we talk about how the planet looks like in 100 years, it sounds a very distant future, but in fact it's not. And he really visualizes that with stories of how his grandparents and his parents explored Iceland and how much the landscape changed in that time. And he really creates an understanding for how close related the change has been in the past, let's say 100, 150 years. Really a great, great read. That was almost in one sitting. And we put a link in the show notes of an interview with the Emergence podcast, or Emergence Magazine podcast, that has an interview with him, almost an hour, on that subject, on that matter. He is like really my most favorite author of all times. He really manages to cover so many different topics in a way that's really fun to read and to pick the book up over and over again. Andrés Naya Magnusson, On Time and Water. And it's available in I don't know how many languages. I think it's already 17 languages.
Oops. All right.
Great.
Okay, thank you, both of you, for digging into your large bookshelves. I know.
I just want to show you one book.
What?
When you talk about
this is well-read
books. Last Antarctic season, before COVID actually crashed everything down, I was very, very pleased by sharing a cabin with David Toffler, which is an Australian kayak guide. And he was reading a book, and I was just thinking, mate, this book looks so, so gross. What happened to that? Oh, I got that from a colleague, and he took it into the sauna. And after he finished, he just passed it on to me, and I finished it, and now it's in my bookshelf. It's like a biography of Roald Amundsen, really nice, The Last Viking. But I just wanted to show it because of how it looks like.
Book.
it's a treasure because it really paints a picture of his character. But the book is just
apart. Anyway, it has character. Let's say it has character. This brings us to the end of this episode. If anyone out there wants to see more books, I know there is plenty more where those came from. You guys must have like walls of books. So I'm, the stacks come out. Okay. So, that would be my suggestion. Everyone make sure to, give us your feedback online and of course on YouTube. And that was it. Until next time, everyone, take care.